Hello everyone, let us look at the MT1 solutions. This exam happened on 11th February for the academic year 19-20 for the students of Triple E branch of E2 second semester. Your question paper contains two sections. The first section have 5 objective questions and you have to answer all the 5 objective questions. Each one of them carries 1 mark. The first question is about finding out whether the signals are periodic or not. The first signal out of it is x1 of t is equal to 2 cos of 2 pi t by 3 plus 3 sin of 3 pi t by 4. This is sum of 2 sinusoidal continuous time signals. A sinusoidal continuous time signal is always periodic irrespective of this ratio we consider 2 pi by omega naught, which is nothing but the period. So the value of the period is 3, which is computed by 2 pi by omega naught for the first signal, which is cos 2 pi t by 3, and for the second signal is 2 pi by omega 1, where omega 1 is equal to 3 pi by 4. If you substitute that here, pi pi will get cancelled and you will get 8 by 3. There is a notational mistake that I did here. This is t naught equal to 3 and t1 is equal to 8 by 3. What is important to us is the ratio of these two. The sum of these two periodic signals will be periodic only if this ratio that we have is a rational number. We can see that the ratio here is 9 by 8, which is a rational number, and hence the signal x1 of t is periodic. Now let us move on to the next signal. x2 of n is equal to 2 cos of 2 pi n by 3 plus 3 sin of 3 pi n by 4. Unlike a continuous time periodic, a continuous time sinusoidal signal, a discrete time sinusoidal signal is not always periodic. It is periodic only if the ratio 2 pi by omega naught, small omega naught, is a rational number. For the first signal, 2 pi by small omega naught is equal to 3, hence the first signal is periodic signal. For the second signal, 2 pi by omega 1 is equal to 8 by 3. This is also a rational number, hence this signal is also periodic. For discrete time signals, the periods are always supposed to be integers. So the period of this is 3 and the period of this is 8, not 8 by 3. It should be an integer, so it is 8. Now if you consider the ratio of the 2, it will be always a rational number. Hence x2 of n, which is a sum of 2 discrete sinusoidal signals which are periodic, is a periodic signal. So the answer for this question is both x1 of t and x2 of n, they are periodic signals. Move on to the next question. The next question is to find out whether the given system is a linear system or a causal system or a time variant or a time invariant system. You can see here the given system is y of t is equal to x of minus t. Let us first deal with the linearity. For the linearity, when x1 of t is applied, we assume that the output is y1 of t and the corresponding output we got is x1 of minus t, vice versa for the second signal as well. Now, if I apply a linear combination of x1 of t and x2 of t, the output also should be linear combination of y1 of t and y2 of t with the corresponding coefficients. You can see the output here when applied ax1 of t plus bx2 of t is ax1 of minus t plus bx2 of minus t, which is in turn equal to a into y1 of t plus b into y2 of t. Hence, the system is a linear system. Now, for causality, here I have applied a negative value of n, which is n is equal to minus 3. Further, the corresponding output came as x of 3, which means that the output at n is equal to minus 3 depends on the future value of the input, which is x of 3. Hence, this system is a non-causal system. Now, let us move on to the time variance and time invariance of this question. For determining whether it is time variant or time invariant, we need to apply a delayed input signal, which is x of t minus t naught. The corresponding output we got it as x of minus t minus t naught. And let us delay the output signal. If I delay the output signal, it is y of t minus t naught. the corresponding value is x of minus of t minus t naught, which gives rise to x of minus t plus t naught. You can easily see that these two are not equal. Hence, this is a time variant system. So, the given signal is only linear but not causal, and it is a time variant system, not a time invariant system. Okay. So, let us move on to the next question. The next question, there are two statements given and we need to see which one of them is true and which one of them is false. The first statement says signal can neither be periodic nor be non-periodic, which is a false statement. The reason is simple. The signal will either be a periodic signal or a non-periodic signal. It has to be one of them. It cannot be, you know, neither be periodic nor be non-periodic. So, the first statement is false. Let us move on to the next statement. It says a periodic signal is always energy signal. When you consider a periodic signal, you can see that the energy over a finite period is a constant value, and a periodic signal is going to repeat itself from minus infinite to infinite for after every capital T. So, it is simply summation of that energy in one period over infinite times. So, the energy will be infinite here and the power will be a finite value. When the energy is infinite and power is a finite value, it is called a power signal, not an energy signal. So, a periodic signal is an energy signal, no, not an energy signal, but it is a power signal. So, this statement is also false. Let us move on to the next question. The next question says that h of n is equal to 0 for n less than 0. So, it is asked if it is a causal system or not. If h of n is equal to 0 for n less than 0, the system is causal if and only if the system is LSI system. So, there is, in the question, there is no inference given about whether the signal is an LSI, whether the system is an LSI system or not. So, we cannot definitely say whether the system is a causal system or not. Hence, the option is D, which is none of the above. Okay. Now, let us move on to the next question. The question is about energy of the signals, whether they are being having same energy as that of f of t or not. If you consider f of minus t, if you and you do the mathematics here, just replace minus t with tau and find out the energy of f of minus t, it will come as the energy, same as the energy of f of t. Similarly, f of t minus capital T, if you find the energy, it will be the energy will be the same again. It's simple mathematics will give you the answer. The point is simple here. If you flip the signal, it is the same signal again. No amplitude is going to change. And again, f of t minus capital T is simply a shift in the time. And hence, here also, no energy is going to change. Now, if you look at f of 2t, there is scaling in time. When I do the scaling in time, the energy is supposed to change. You can see that here. 2t is equal to tau I am keeping, and if you do the mathematics, it will come as capital E by 2. So, if 2t is equal to capital, 2t is equal to tau, 2 into dt is equal to d tau. So, I am replacing dt with d tau by 2 here, and 2t here I am replacing it with the tau, and the limits are not going to change, because if I put minus infinite here, tau will become minus infinite. If t I will put plus infinite, tau is going to become plus infinite. So, the value of the energy is going to be half of the original signal. So, I don't see whether the option is B or C or whatever. I am not confident about this, but the point is that f of t, f of minus t, f of t minus capital T will have same energy as that of f of t, but not f of 2t. Let us move on to the subjective questions. There are three subjective questions given to you and you need to answer two of them. Let us look into the first question. The question is, there is a signal x of t given to you and you needed to find out x of minus 2t plus 2, and then you needed to find out the even part of the signal and odd part of the signal. So, when coming to the first part of the question, you needed to find out x of minus 2t plus 2. Look at this signal x of t. You can easily say that the trends in the signal are changing, the trend in the signal is changing at t is equal to minus 1 and t is equal to 0, t is equal to 1 and t is equal to 2. If I am able to map these instances of time to the new signal x of minus 2t plus 2, then I can easily draw the signal x of minus 2t plus 2, because here simply a linear variation is there. To draw a straight line, we just need to find out the two points, that's all. So now let us do that quickly. I'm trying to find out here at what value of t x of minus 2t plus 2 takes the value of x of t at t equal to minus 1. I'm making minus 2t plus 2 equal to minus 1, and the t now came as 3/2. And similarly, I want to find out at what value of t x of minus 2t plus 2 takes the value of x of t at t is equal to 0, and the corresponding value came as 1. So I will do the same thing for the remaining values, which are 1 and 2 also, and the corresponding values are half and 0. So what I need to do here, just take the value which is present at t equal to minus 1 and keep the value at t is equal to 3/2. So the value at t is equal to minus 1 here is 0. That value now I am going to keep at t is equal to 3/2, and the value is 0 here again. And similarly, the value at t is equal to 0 is 1 here, and that value I am going to keep at t is equal to 1. This is the value. Similarly, I am going to do it for the next two samples also, and this is the resultant signal, which is x of minus 2t plus 2. Let us move on to the next part of this question. Next part of this question is to find out x of t plus x of minus t by 2, which is the even part, x of t minus x of minus t by 2, which is the odd part. So let us first flip the signal. X of minus t is this, I'm just flipping this. So this 2 will become minus 2 and it will come here, vice versa. And this is the flipped version of the signal x of t. And now I need to find out the average of these two signals. Simply you just add the value of the two signals at each and every value of time and then divide it with 2. So you have to be careful with the magnitudes of the signal here. So now, for example, I have a t equal to minus 2, the value here is 0, and at t equal to minus 2, the value is 0. So if I add these two, I'll get 0 here, and at t equal to minus 1, the value is 0 here, at t equal to minus 1, the value is minus 1 here. If I add these two, I will get minus 1, and I need to average it, you remember, if you, so this will be minus half, not minus 1, okay. So this is, I think that plus sign is missing here, this is minus half, okay. Similarly, at t is equal to 0, the value here is 1 and the value here is also 1. So it is 1 plus 1 by 2, which is 1 again. Now, if I find out this part of the signal, it is easy to draw the other part. Although you can do, you know, follow the same process again, but there is a shortcut here. This is supposed to be an even signal. Hence, you can draw the same signal flipped here. That will give you the even part of the signal. And similarly, the odd part of the signal can be obtained by subtracting the value of x of t, subtracting the value of x of minus t from the value of x of t at each and every instance of time and divide it with 2. So that will result in this value. And there is one clue here, whether what you have done is correct or not. If you want to find out, you just see the value at t is equal to 0 and it is supposed to be coming as 0, because the value of the odd signal at t equal to 0 is supposed to be 0. So now let us move on to the next question. The next question has two parts in it. The first part, it is asked for the relation between the input and output of an LTI system. The relation between the input and output of an LTI system or LSI system is the convolution of the input with the impulse response of the LSI or LTI system. The derivation is taught in the class and you can refer your notes. Now, moving to the next part of the question, h of t is given as u of t and x of t is given as u of t plus 1 minus 2 into u of t minus 1 plus u of t. We are asked to find out the convolution of these two, x of t and h of t. Now, instead of directly computing this convolution, I am computing d by dt of h of t, which is delta of t. So, I am going to find out the convolution of this first with respect to delta of t, which is going to give me x of t convolved with the delta of t here will be same as x of t. Hence, d by dt of h of t convolved with x of t is equal to u of t plus 1 minus 2 into u of t minus 1 plus u of t. which is same as x of t again. Now, how to get from this to x of t convolved with h of t? By integrating here. This is only possible because the system is an LTI system. Now, computing that convolution by integrating this part here, I am integrating this. So, integral over minus infinite to t, u of tau plus 1 d tau minus 2 into integral over minus infinite to t, u of tau minus 1 d tau plus integral over minus infinite to t, u of tau d tau. The integration of this, integration of a step function, is basically a ramp function here with shifted by the same amount of time. So, this is r of t plus 1 and this is going to become r of t minus 1 and this is going to become r of t. Now, we are asked to draw the signal. So, let us try to draw the signal. R of t plus 1 will start at t is equal to minus 1. The value at t is equal to 0 is equal to 1, at t equal to 1 is 2, at t equal to 2 is 3, at t equal to 3 is 4, vice versa. Now, this is r of t will start at 0 and the corresponding values are shown at t equal to 0, 0, at t equal to 1, 1, t equal to 2, 2, so on. Now, let us draw 2 into r of t minus 1. This r of t minus 1 is going to start at 1 and you can see the slope is, the value of the slope is 2. So, here it is the value here at t equal to 1 is 0 because this is going to be 2 into t minus 1, instead of t we need to put now t equal to 1. So, 1 minus 1 is going to become 0. Now, at t is equal to 2, the value of this is going to become 2 into t minus 1. So, 2 minus 1 is going to become 1. 2 into 1 is going to become 2. So, at the value at t equal to 2 is 2 and the value at t equal to 3 is 4. So, on. Now, we need to add these two and subtract it here. Adding r of t plus 1 with r of t and this value is subtracted from the resultant. Now, at t equal to minus 1, the value of this is equal to 0, the value of this is equal to 0, the value of this is equal to 0. So, at t equal to minus 1, the value is equal to 0. And t equal to 1, the value of this is 1, 1 plus 0 and minus 0 is going to give 1. Now, at t equal to 1, the value of this is 2, the value of this is 1, 2 plus 1, 3, and the value of this is equal to 0. So, 3 minus 0 is 3. Now, let us look at t equal to 2. At t equal to 2, the value here is 3. At t equal to 2, the value here is 2. 3 plus 2 is 5. 5 minus 2 is 3. And if you look at t is equal to 3, the value here is 4. The value here is 3. 4 plus 3 is 7. Minus the value here is at t equal to 3, the value of this is 3 minus 1, which is 2, 2 into 2, 4. So, this is 7 minus 4, again 3. So, even if you find it further, the value is going to remain at 3. So, this is how we can draw the signal y of t. Moving on to the next question. The next question again have two parts. The first part is to evaluate this one. So, in evaluating this one, integral over minus infinite to infinite f of tau delta of t minus tau delta of t minus 2 d tau. This delta of t minus 2, it is independent of tau. I am writing it outside. Integral over minus infinite to infinite f of tau delta of t minus tau d tau. This is nothing but convolution of f of t with delta of t, which is going to give me f of t. Now, this is equal to delta of t minus 2 multiplied with f of t using the shifting property of the impulse function, this will be equal to f of 2 multiplied with delta of t minus 2. So, this is the answer for it. The next question is to find out a condition for the system to be stable. So, this derivation is however done in the class. So, you are requested to refer your class notes. Okay. So, happy computing. We'll hopefully meet again.